And my material then, my empirical material, was formed chiefly by lunatics, by cases of schizophrenia. And there I had observed that there are, chiefly in the beginning of a disease, invasions of fantasies into conscious life, fantasies of an entirely unexpected sort, most bewildering to the patient. He gets quite confused by these ideas, and he gets into a sort of panic, because he never before has thought such things, that they are quite strange to him, and equally strange to his physician. Mm-hmm. You see, the alien is equally dumbfounded. Yes. By the peculiar character of those fantasies.
Yes.
And therefore one says, that man is crazy.
Yes.
Crazy.
Yes.
To think such things. Nobody.
Yes.
Thinks such.
Yes.
Things.
Yes.
And the patient agrees in a way with him. If he would at least agree, or he does even agree, and all the more he gets into a panic. So, as a alienist, I thought it to be really the task for psychiatry to elucidate that thing that broke into consciousness, these voices, these delusions.
Yes.
In those days, that is, mind you, more than 40 years ago, or almost 50 years ago, I had no hope to be able to treat these cases or to be able to help them, but I had a very great scientific curiosity, and I wanted to know what these things really were, because I thought that these things had a system. They were not merely chaotic, decayed material, because there was too much sense in those fantasies. So what I did then was I studied cases of psychogenic diseases like hysteria, hysteric somnambulism, and such things, where the content that came from the unconscious were in a readable condition, in an understandable condition. And then I saw that, in contradistinction to the schizophrenics, the mental contents of hysterics were of a humanly understandable character. They were even elaborate, dramatic, suggestive, insinuating. So one could make out a second personality. Now, this is not the case of schizophrenia. There the fantasies, on the contrary, are unsystematic, chaotic, and you cannot make out a proper second personality, apart from rare cases of a complicated nature. Now, I knew of psychopathic cases, just no, in the balance between schizophrenia and hysteria, where ideas came up, delusions that were not exactly hysterical, because they were singularly difficult to understand. It was a sort of strange eruptions, and I thought that these cases could give me a better understanding. So I took the opportunity when Professor Flurma, the old professor of psychology and philosophy at the University of Geneva, when he published a case of an American girl who had bestowed upon him a series of half poetic and romantic fantasies, he published these, that material without commenting on them. He gave it as an example of creative imagination. Now, when I read those fantasies, I saw this is exactly the material. I was always a bit afraid when I that people, when I tell of my personal experiences with patients, that they would say, oh, this is a merely suggestion, you know.
Yeah.
I took that case because I surely had no hand in it. It was old Professor Fulmer, an authority. He was a friend of William James. I knew him personally, a very fine old man. And he certainly wouldn't be accused of,
that's right,
of having influenced the patient.
Yes.
And that is the reason why I analyzed these fantasies. And that that case became the object of a whole book called The Psychology of Unconscious. It is called now Symbolisms of Transformation.
Yes.
And I have revised it after 40 years. It needed it.
Yeah.
Because it was in the first attempt.
Yeah. Yeah.
And there I tried to show that there is a sort of unconscious, I then simply called it the unconscious, that clearly produces things which are historical and not personal.
Yes.
It was mythological material of the nature of which wasn't understood neither by Professor Fulmer nor by the patient. And and there I tried for the first time to produce a picture of the functioning of the unconscious. A functioning which allowed certain conclusions as to the nature of the unconscious. Then, after I had written that book, that cost me my friendship with Freud because he couldn't accept it.
Yes.
To him, the unconscious was a product of consciousness.
Yes.
And it simply contained the remnants. I mean, it was a sort of storeroom where all the discarded things of consciousness were heaped up and left. But to me, the unconscious then was already a matrix, a sort of basis of consciousness of a creative nature, namely capable of autonomous acts, autonomous intrusions into consciousness.
Yes.
In other words, I took the existence of the unconscious for a real fact, or for a real autonomous factor capable of independent action.
Yes.
And now that was a problem, a psychological problem of the very first order. And that made me think, and furiously, because the role of philosophy nowadays has not yet recognized this fact, that we have a counteractor in our unconscious, that in our psyche there are two consciousnesses, one factor, and there is another factor equally important, that is the unconscious, that can interfere with consciousness any time it pleases. And of course I say to myself now, this is very uncomfortable, because I think I am the only master in my house, but I must admit that there is another somebody in that house that can play tricks. And I had to deal with the unfortunate victims of that interference every day in my patients. So the next thing I wrote was in 1918, namely a disquisition about the relation between the ego and the unconscious. where I tried to formulate the experiences that are more or less regularly observable in cases where consciousness is exposed to unconscious doubts, or interferences or intrusions, where the unconscious is considered as an autonomous factor that has to be taken seriously, where one cannot, where one doesn't say anymore or undervalue the unconscious by assuming it is nothing but a discarded remnant of consciousness. It is a factor in its own dignity, and a very important factor, because it can create the most horrible disturbances. Now, when that was a pamphlet I wrote, it was published in French, and nobody understood it. I saw that the reason why nobody understands it is that while nobody has a similar experience, because the question hasn't been pursued to such an end, namely that one has taken the unconscious seriously and considered it as a real factor that can determine human behavior to a very considerable degree.
Do you think that the humanities are important for the individual who wants to study the individual?
One doesn't see what an education without humanities is doing to man.
Okay.
He loses the connection with his family, as it were. That means with the whole stem, the tribe, the connection with the past, that he lives in, that in which man always has lived. Man has always lived in the myth. And we think we are able to be born today and to live in no myth, without history. That is a disease. That's absolutely abnormal, because man is not born every day. He is once born in a specific historical setting with the specific historical qualities, and therefore he is only complete when he has a relation to these things. It's just as if you were born without eyes and ears, when you are growing up with no connection with the past. From the sample of natural science, you need no connection with the past. You can wipe it out.
Yes, yes.
And that is a mutilation of the human being. Now I saw from a practical experience that this kind of proceeding had a most extraordinary therapeutic effect. I can tell you such a case. That was a young Jewish girl, and she, her father was a banker, and she had received an entirely worldly education. She had no idea of any tradition or so. And then I went further into her history and found out that her grandfather had been a sadik in Galicia, and when I knew that, I knew the whole story. That girl suffered from a phobia, a terrific phobia, and had been in a psychoanalytic treatment already, with no effect. And she was really badly plagued by that phobia, anxiety states of all sorts. And then I saw that girl has lost the connection with the past, has lost, for instance, the fact that her grandfather was a sadik, that he lived in the myth, and her father has fallen out of it too. So I simply told her, You see, you will understand what your fear is. You know what you have lost. And the teacher said, of course not. I said, your fear is the fear of your way. You know, the effect was that within a week she was cured from so many years of bad anxiety state. Because you see, that went like a lightning through her. But I only could say it because I knew that she is absolutely lost. She thought she was in the middle of things, but she was lost, gone. No, made no sense. Well, what is our existence, you know, when we are just average numbers, you know. The more you make people to average numbers, the more you destroy our society. Yes. The ideal state is then a slave state, then you can go to Russia, there is wonderful. There you can be a number, but one pays it very dearly. Our whole life goes into blazes.
Okay.
And so we had plenty of cases of a similar kind. And that has naturally led me on to a profound study of the archetype. I got more and more respectful of archetypes, and now, by Jove, that thing should be taken into account. That is an enormous factor, very important for our further development and for our well-being. Now, in it was of course difficult to know where to begin because this is such an enormously extended field, and the next question I asked myself was, now where in the world has anybody been busy with that problem? And I found nobody, except a peculiar spiritual movement that went together with the beginnings of Christianity, namely the Gnostics. That was the first thing I said, and then I saw they were concerned with the problem of archetypes, and made a peculiar philosophy of it. As everybody makes a peculiar philosophy of it when he comes across it naively and doesn't know that those are structural elements of the unconscious psyche. Now they have lived in the first, second, and third century, and what was in between? Nothing. And now today we suddenly fall into that hole. And are confronted by the problems of the collective unconscious, which were then the same in 2,000 years ago, and we are not prepared to meet that problem. I was always looking for something in between, you know, something that linked that remote past with the present moment, and I found, to my amazement, it is alchemy. That is understood to be a history of chemistry. It is, one could almost say, nothing less than that. It is a peculiar spiritual movement or philosophical movement. They call themselves philosophers, like Gnosticism. And then I read the whole accessible literature, Latin and Greek, studied it. Because it was enormously interesting. It is the mental work of 1,700 years in which there is stored up all that he could make out about the nature of the archetypes in a peculiar way. That's true. It is not simple. And you know, most of the texts are not published, no more published since the Middle Ages. The last editions are in the middle or end of the 16th century, all in Latin, and and subjects of intrigue, and not a few very important ones. Now, that has given me no end of work, but the result was most satisfactory because it showed me the development of our unconscious relations to the collective unconscious and the variations our consciousness has undergone while being unconsciously concerned with these mythological images. For instance, such phenomena as in Hitler or so, you know, that's an archetypal phenomena, and we've got to understand these things. It's just as so as if a terrific epidemic of typhoid fever were breaking out, and we say, now this is typhoid fever, isn't that a marvelous disease? It can take on enormous dimensions, and nobody knows anything about it. Nobody takes care of the water supply. Nobody thinks of examining the meat or something like that. What simply states that this is a phenomenon, yes, but one doesn't understand it. And to me, of course, it was an enormous problem. Because it is a factor that has determined the fate of millions of European people and of Americans. It is nobody can deny that he has been influenced by the war. But that is all Hitler's doing, and that's all psychology, our foolish psychology. But you only come to an understanding of these things when you understand the background.
Yes.
From which it springs.
Yes.
And so, of course, I cannot tell you in detail about about alchemy. It is the basis of our modern way of perceiving things, and therefore, it is as if it were right under the threshold of consciousness. This is a wonderful picture of how the development of archetypes, that means the movement of archetypes, looks when you look upon them as a form of love, maybe from today you look back into the past and you see how the present moment has evolved out of the past. It is just as if the alchemistic philosophy, it sounds very curious, we should give it an entirely different name, it has a different name, it's called Hermetic philosophy, of course that conveys just as little as the term alchemy.
Yeah.
It is the parallel development, as Gnosticism was, to the conscious development, say, of Christianity, of our Christian philosophy, of the whole psychology of the Middle Ages. And so you see, in our days, we have such and such view of the world, such and such a philosophy, but in the unconscious we have a different one. And that we can see in, through the example of the alchemistic philosophy that behaves towards the medieval consciousness exactly like the unconscious behaves to ourselves. And we can construct or even predict our the unconscious of our days when we know what it has been yesterday. Now that is with a few words the development of my ideas. I really help going into detail, I couldn't elaborate.
You have gone into great detail elsewhere, though, much of your writing, of course.
Well, people have to read the books finally, in spite of the fact that they are thick.
And we're hoping.
I'm sorry.